think it's a part of both. I don't think there's an optimal structure personally, because it also depends on your industry. There's a lot of variables within that. I'd say the constants that I can think of is the metrics in which you use, the data which isn't available, and the frequency of what you look at that data, which causes that nimbleness. So as a startup, as I said, we have a lot of that data available. We use it, and then we take decisions based on it, and then we structure a bit around that. And I mean, from what I can see, you have various teams all the time. You have a strategy office, we have a what called chief of staff office, so we have project teams. To be honest, as long as we're all aligned around the values, I think in Tom's presentation, that's what's more important to me in the structure. So the principles in which you really live by are what's more important. And then you build the structures around it. Because to be honest, I'm sure all the companies to some extent have similar teams, they're just called different names. What it boils down to is what the CEO or the founders drive as the key values and how that transposes through the organization. And then that structure, I mean, it's the bones, but what's really important is the core of all that. And certainly I see that one of our principles is to outserve, and we do somewhat live that. And another one is your problem is my problem. So we do have an integration. I have online teams visit my office in the operation once or twice a week at least. They help to customize and design different things that help our team. We have turnaround times in 6 hours. When I was in the banking industry, we'd never heard of those things. So we have hourly kind of turnaround times, and we meet them a lot of the time, at least half of the time, with regard to the assistance from the other businesses. And I believe that comes from the core values and not the structure of the organization.
Yeah.
Of course, we still got lots of work to do, but.
Oh, that makes sense. When you need to start with the business strategy, the culture as well, the importance of values that needs to be embodied by the employees, right? So maybe a segue into your environment and how do you make that a reality? And I don't know, some of you might have attended a session earlier with Zalora that was talking about how to get rid of this. It's not my responsibility type of pushback.
That's where I got it from. Thanks, Jonathan.
it was pretty good, and Zara uses customer journey mapping and voice of the customer session where they share the voice of the customer in order to make sure that everybody is aligned on the values. Is that something that you're trying to do, or is that the pushback that you're getting from your employees as well?
Well, I think it's a very difficult challenge for a company like ours. Obviously, we've got lots of different kind of service line and geography sort of matrix structure. And, you know, there are good reasons for why that is the case, but it may not be serving us to be agile around our customers as much as we'd like to. I think that there's certainly an argument to look at the organizational structure and whether or not there's a way to make that enable that more customer-centric mindset, but I do somewhat agree that the culture that you have is equally important and building trust. I mean, you cannot have that volume of people really working together as one team and just jumping in, it would be chaos. So you need to have some sort of a structure. People have to sit somewhere in the organization. But can you build, and what I'm very passionate about, is how can we build more trust between teams? So that whilst, yes, I may belong to this team and be very passionate to my team, but I also have a vested interest in the success of another team, and I know that I can reach out to them for support, and that they will treat my customer and my customer's issue with just the equal level of care that I would. So thinking about how to build that in a different sort of way is something that we're looking at very hard. You know, at JLL we have some really core values around trust and professionalism and teamwork, which our client—that's what we hear from our clients—that they value about us. The piece that we want to add is that sort of agility and ability to organise ourselves differently around our client. And I think the culture and trust is just as important as the structure.
Got it. So just focusing on the organizational structure, well, I mean, we'll only get you so far, right? You need to add also other things in terms of culture.
Yeah, and I also
the metrics that you were talking about.
Yeah, and I was just I was also going to say, if you decided, oh, let's just change our structure, and you haven't worked on the culture and the trust to support that, then I don't think you would have a great level of success in making the change.
Yeah, there's a management saying that, you know, say something like structure for the strategy. Right? You need to start with the strategy and the backbone that we're talking about in order to make this strategy a reality. Manish, talking about organizational structure, and maybe to go back on some of the changes that we've witnessed over the years in terms of who owns the customer engagement.
I think there's no real, I would say, one answer for that, but in my perspective, each and every employee or staff of the organization involved in making customers smile, I would say, are responsible for getting customer engagement. But yeah, so that's what my definition was. But I think traditionally, if you look at it, it has been into the hands of those customer service, customer support people. I mean, they are the ones who get connected with customers by call or email, and then probably the branch people, customer visits to the branch. And third is marketing. You know, they reach out to the customers through advertisements or means where. So I would say traditionally it remains into this, and I think I would agree with the word that I was mentioning about the culture and how we can learn from the team and being a trust for the performance. It's about how you can break in the silos. Earlier this customer engagement was managing silos with marketing, with customer service, with merch, and you know, how we try to design furniture. I think I would say this arrived, and I would say that that's why the senior executives are taking it out from the top to bottom, so they can get the silos. And anything you do, there is a true representation of the customers, you know, liking or disliking, so that the right outcome can be intervened and then and applied to solve issues or to augment the good practice. So that is what I would say customer engagement is about. It is being at the C level, and it has been across the enterprise. It's not for the silos of the department.
Yeah, that's what to complement that point, I mean, I think, as you said earlier, the process doesn't run linear anymore. And for example, myself, even though I'm in an operation, I sit in demand generation weekly. I understand the promotion mechanics. I sit with marketing at least twice a week. I also sit with all the revenue generators in the verticals, we call them, in terms of that engagement to build both the relationship and understand the model. Certainly, I also think we do differently is we really go down the experience platform, which is something that's also new to us. I drive, as a car driver. I sit in our contact centers, I take calls, and the whole leadership team is what it's structured within our platform that is defined. And that builds a certain type of empathy for what the platform would look like as a business, and it's something that helps break down those silos. We also have, in the introduction of every staff, we have the longest period of for my department, which is the CX platform, built in so everybody kind of understands the metrics of what we're doing, to try to create that better line of tools to make sure that we're aligned around that. So we're trying to build the ecosystem in that culture, but there's some quick wins you can do, which are really
information on the back of your head, not going to my laptop, find it in the Confluence page or in the central repository. You don't have time to be thinking that way. So until you experience that, that's why we're also looking at, for example, that instance of the experience when an online team did it, we're now looking at potential AI to filter out some of our information. And that came because an online team on a hackathon came down and sat with us and did that. So if you can promote those kind of activities, it will indeed induce changes within your organization. To complement those two questions.
I just would like to add, I think you truly mentioned, so the things which I have been seeing now in some of the organizations out there. So basically just now you mentioned about knowledge management. You have all kind of knowledge libraries, articles residing, but as you say rightly that when the questions are given to your employee, then you need to have it here. You cannot go and Google it and then read top 3 and 5 and then give the answer or by time. No, you already negatively score to your customer service. So it's all about how do you, what we call it is employee empowerment. And nowadays we all know the automation and artificial intelligence, these are the kind of booms getting into it. But at the end of the day, what eventually is going to have or make it truly successful is when you empower the employee with the more information. So when you have a knowledge management system, and when the interaction is happening either on the chat or on the browser or on the phone call, so there is a real time, somebody is watching it, and then you need to get married. So if the questions are, what we call it contextually, asked in the email, on the phone call, and somebody need to get to index the knowledge management to pull out automatically the right article or the right solution to that particular employee so that he can instantly provide the answer. So I see the marriages of the, also the breaking the silos of the technology which was managed in the silos. So knowledge management was more like a CRM tool, the ACD communications or email management is a different department, but now they are coming together to answer the, enriching the customer experience by empowering the employee.
It's about democratization.
Absolutely, yes.
How do you empower, equip the right employee with the right information at the right time?
Exactly. I think that's all about it.
But you mentioned something also interesting, which is how do you build empathy for another function's goals and objectives, right? So how do you do that? Do you have programs where employees move around in the organization so that they know how to, do the call center, but they also know how to do marketing, and how does it work?
So I think you have to do that. I think it's easier said than done.
Yeah.
I personally do that to try to set the standard, but then also in our case, the online teams do come to visit us because it comes from the top. So the founders are very passionate about service and they want, for example, Ling, who's our online head, she's the brain on that aspect. She requires all the online teams to come down, the product teams, to experience what it is for our customers, to set that standard, I suppose. And so at the end of the day, we're doing it that way. I think there is still a tension. We also have silos like most companies, but what we do is we just communicate as much as possible and we force, to some extent, that interaction. I think we would do that's not any different than anybody else, but we really push that across, that online teams will visit, the offline teams should be integrated, and then they've even sort of restructured the naming of families to incorporate not having those silos.